My name is Noise of Running Feet. I am a Nez Perce woman, and I have a story to tell. In the fall of 1877, my father, Chief Joseph, surrendered to the U.S. Army while leading the Nez Perce and retreat to Canada. Our people were starving and freezing, so he saved our lives instead of chasing pride and legacy. His stoic submission led to the Nez Perce being immediately forced onto tiny reservations that I strongly hope and believe will be expanded because of his cooperation. We lived in the Wallawa Valley, several days' journey from the Pacific Ocean. Our land streams flowed with fish, and tall, abundant grass carpeted the rich soil. In the early 1800s, the Nez Perce met Lewis and Clark. We aided them on their journey. We were friends with the white men, or as we call them, Soyapo. In the 1830s, missionaries came to the Nez Perce who lived in Lapway to colonize them. Lapway was several days away from our valley. My grandfather, Tuekekus, chief of our tribe, was eager to learn from them. He traveled to Lapway to meet with them and was converted to Christianity. But in 1848, gold was discovered in California. People rushed out west, scrambling to find a fortune of their own. At first, they were content to settle out on the coast. But when that filled up, eyes turned towards Nez Perce land. The U.S. government sent negotiators to barter for the land. They forced their treaties on us by finding loopholes in the legal system and threatening to take the lands by force. We were bound to restricted reservations by treaties that we did not agree to. My grandfather was enraged. He tore his Bible and cursed the white men. He spent the last few years of his life instructing my father, Joseph the Younger, to prepare him to lead his people. You must stop your ears whenever you are asked to sign a treaty selling your home. This land holds your father's body. Never sell the bones of your father and your mother. In August of 1871, as my grandfather lay dying, my father swore to him to protect the valley for the rest of his life. In 1877, a council was held between many Indian chiefs, including my father, and a white man known as General Howard. Howard had been sent by the U.S. government to force the Nez Perce onto the Lapway Reservation. The chiefs resisted, struggling to maintain the independence of their people. At one point during the council, Chief Tuhulhuzut flew into a rage. Who are you to speak for this land? I am of this land. But despite the chief's firm position, Howard was not persuaded, and we had 30 days to move on to the reservation. My father loved his people so much that he decided to break his final vow to his father and obey the government's wishes to ensure their safety by moving on to the Lapway Reservation. However, during our journey, we learned that a young Nez Perce Indian had avenged his father's death by brutally slaughtering several white settlers. Now the Soyapo feared and hated us more than ever, and we could never be safe on the reservation. We remembered Chief Sitting Bull up in Canada, who had fought the U.S. Army and now lived out of reach of the government. Maybe we could go and seek refuge with him. And so, July 16th, 1877, when I was 12, we left, 800 people running to freedom. But of course, the army was following close behind us. Some days, they would be far behind, and we would be able to move slowly and regain our strength. Other days, though, would be less friendly, and we would hurry on, silent, lest the army discover us. On one such day, an infant was wailing. Its mother tried everything to comfort it, rocking it and cooing to it softly. Its cries continued, and in desperation, knowing what would happen to her entire tribe if they were found, she smashed its head against a tree, leaving it silent and lifeless. But not even this was enough to save us. In the late fall, we straggled on 1,400 miles away from our home, into the Bear Paw Mountains of Montana. We woke up one late fall morning, a mere 40 miles from our freedom, sure that the army was far behind us. But in the middle of the morning, we were attacked. My father handed me the reins to my horse. He told me to ride and not stop until I had reached Canada. I saw his heartbroken eyes as he faded into the distance. He could have come with me. We could have been free together. Instead, he stayed to speak for his tribe, to save their lives, even if it meant breaking his own. I later heard the full story. After several days of failed negotiations, my father decided to surrender. I believe this is the bravest thing he ever did. Many of our people did not support this decision, especially the young men, and wanted to fight the whites to the death or make a daring escape to Canada. When surrendering, my father knew that he would most likely be hung for treason. He would never be remembered as a great Nez Perce liberator leading his people to freedom, and he would never see his home or family again. But my father saw past the ambition, the fear, the hatred, and the love. And he saw the old women and tender infants who could not survive the harsh winter. He saw young children alone in the wilderness, fleeing from gunfire. And he could not sentence them to these ends. So he addressed soldier and Indian alike, saying, "I am tired of fighting. Our chiefs are killed. Looking Glass is dead. Tuhulhuzult is dead. The old men are all dead. It is the young men who say yes or no. He who led the young men is dead. It is cold and we have no blankets. The little children are freezing to death. My people, some of them, have run away to the hills and have no blankets, no food. No one knows where they are, perhaps freezing to death. I want to have time to look for my children and see how many of them I can find. Maybe I shall find them among the dead. Hear me, my chiefs. I am tired. My heart is sick and sad. From where the sun now stands, I will fight no more forever." After this, my people were carted off by trains or on foot. I was one of the few who escaped the battle and made it to Canada. I later returned to Lapway to be with my people, and I heard their stories. They were first taken to Eastern reservations, but most were eventually returned to Lapway. We fear that there will be later treaties taking away more and more Indian land. Meanwhile, Americans began marketing my father, calling him names like War Chief Joseph and the Red Napoleon, even featuring him in Buffalo Bill's Wild West show. Eventually, my father was put on a reservation out near the Pacific Ocean. As part of his punishment, I've never been allowed to see him. I believe that my father's surrender will lead to more negotiable terms between the U.S. and the Nez Perce. Instead of all surviving Nez Perce being fugitives returning from Canada, we are a nation, and the government will have to recognize that. I believe that having just one more Indian nation will make Indian laws a higher priority. I believe that there will be later treaties returning our land to us, that one day we will be given the same rights as American citizens, and that the Soyapo will treat us as equals. As for my father, I believe that my people will come to see him as a hero. He saved not only their lives, but the very idea of a Nez Perce nation. Yet all the land and freedom in the world cannot bring back the dead lying in unmarked graves, and no one can put a price on human life. My father knew this when he said, "Good words will not give me back my children."